Our scripture passage today is from the book of Romans. If you've ever taken a look at the New Testament, it's of course the four Gospels and then Acts. And then there's all these books by Paul that are back to back. And I remember in seminary being told that they're not really in order of importance or, you know, favorites. They're in order of size. So if you think of that they were, you know, manuscripts, that they were just put, like I stack my books, largest to smallest. And Romans happens to be the largest. So our passage today is from Romans, Paul's writings to the church in Rome. You know, I think about all the, you know, Rome was the central place for the ancient world. It was the capital of the world, really. And of all the writings from that time, how many of you have ever read anything that was written in Rome, in ancient Rome? It's very few. But yet, every time we open the Bible, we read these letters from Paul to Rome. So even though that was such a great and important place in that time, this humble writing from Paul to the church in Rome is what has lasted through time. And I want to read this whole chapter, even though it's not very long, but I'm only going to focus on a couple of verses, because I want you to get a feel for the importance of Paul. We really are Pauline theology, whether we realize it or not, almost as much as we are Jesus followers. We're Paul followers. He had such an important role in shaping theology. And this chapter just kind of personifies what Paul did in his writings. He was writing to a church, trying to encourage them to be a certain way. And he would write some theology, but a lot of it was really down-to-earth advice. So I just want to read this whole chapter just to show you how he did that. So Romans 12. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. By the grace given to you, I say to everyone among you not to think of yourselves more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, such according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and all in the members have their same function, so we who are many are one body in Christ, and individually we are members one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us: prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the exhorter in exhortation, the giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, the compassionate in cheerfulness. Let love be generous and genuine. Hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal or ardent in spirit, but serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope, be patient in suffering, persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. And bless and do not curse them. Rejoice for those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. I mean, every single line is just, you know, chock full of really amazing Pauline goodness. So I just wanted to share that whole chapter with you to give you a feel of what Paul is like. This whole month, we have focused on firsts, fun firsts. And I'll walk you back through what we've done. And mostly, it's just firsts from my life, if that's okay. It's my first month of being your lead pastor. So I went through and thought about a lot of firsts in my life. One was the first time I gave communion. And on that Sunday, we talked about how, as your pastor, I want to see everyone as worthy, because we have an open communion for everyone. Then the second Sunday, I talked about my very first sermon I gave. And I shared with you my father's 110-pound watermelon that he grew 1 year. And in that story, I was talking about how creative we all are. Jesus just put out all these parables. He was so creative in seeing the world as potential material to talk about God. And we're the same way if we let ourselves. And so I, as your pastor, want to see you as creative. And then I talked about my very first sort of independent religious experience when, after I left home and became an atheist. And then I checked out this really amazing church, Baptist Church of the Covenant in Birmingham, Alabama. And I had that experience of, wow, this is real. Even though I don't believe it, there is something about this that is really real. And so that was my first kind of independent religious experience. Then I shared last week about first love. You can't talk about first and not talk about first love. So I shared about my very first boyfriend. But then I brought it around to talking about how most definitely, without my knowing it, my first love was God's love for me and for each and every one of us. We read the John 3:16 on that last Sunday. So today I want to talk about how I see us all as, every single person, I want to see all of us as worthy, loved, creative, and gifted. So today I want to talk about how we're all very gifted. When we talk about gifted, I want to specifically describe being gifted as the work that we do. It's the work that makes it all come together. And so giftedness is that action that we do, that we bring to the table. You know, when you wash dishes, you wouldn't necessarily call yourself a dishwasher. But if you write or do whatever, giftedness is whatever it is that you would identify yourself as being. We do a lot of things that we wouldn't say that we're necessarily that particular type of person. Like, I don't call myself a dishwasher, but I wash dishes every day. So anyway, it's that part of our life that we pull out and highlight and say, this is really who I am. So we're going to talk about giftedness today. Now, often when it comes to work, sometimes we're unmotivated. We know we have these things in our life that are important, but we might feel unmotivated. When I look back at my life, my parents, we had to work hard. There were five girls, and we worked on my parents had a farm, and we grew all of our own vegetables that we ate all year round. We froze and canned a lot of food, but mostly I thought they just had a farm and a vegetable garden to just keep us busy all summer, right? I mean, it was so much cheaper just to buy it at the grocery store. Nope, they kept us busy all summer long. And one of my favorite memories is, and I say this is my favorite memory because any time that I could kind of laugh at my twin sister was one of my favorite memories. So we were out in the butterbean patch, long, long rows of butterbeans. And if you've ever picked butterbeans, they're short, you know, stubby bushes. And and they're really back-breaking. And my father would plant just really long rows of butter beans. Not that any one family needs that many butter beans, but he did. And so we would all get out there picking, you know, we'd have our row, your row and my row, whatever, your own row, and pick those butter beans. And us children, we had this habit of taking our 5-gallon bucket and sitting on the rim of the bucket, right? Just kind of squat down and sit and then just pick from that sitting position. Well, my favorite memory is that, I'm going to laugh just thinking about it. Brenda got stuck in the 5-gallon bucket. She didn't quite stay on the rim. She just kind of sank down into the 5-gallon bucket. And, you know, it's one of those rare times when we just really did not step in. We did not offer any assistance at all. She was just standing there trying to get out of that bucket and not being able to really, you know, reach. And so she walked around really mad at us for not helping her. Finally, I think my dad came over and helped her. But that's one of my favorite memories. And it really motivated us. I think we finished that row after that funny experience. Finished that row in record time. We got, you know, because we were motivated. We were, it was fun. It was funny. Of course, she was lagging way behind. But we did really great. We did really great because we were motivated. We were motivated from that story. So when you have work to do, you know, motivation is sometimes a problem. Another problem with gifts and the work that's involved in sharing our gifts is sometimes we're unprepared. Honestly, we're just unprepared for the task. I stand before you solidly committed as a pastor, as a United Methodist pastor, very confident that this is what God has planned for me in my life. But the very first church that I applied for a job for, I went through the interview process. It was for a youth position, a youth minister, at Pilgrim Congregational Church in Birmingham, Alabama, United Church of Christ Church. And it was after my atheist time, but I still really didn't know what in the world I was doing, and I was still really confused and felt the nudging of God in the direction of ministry, but had no confidence at all. So I went through the interview process, and they wanted to hire me. And so I remember driving up to the Pilgrim Congregational Church and walking into the pastor's office to talk to him and say, you know, I just can't do this. The very first job I had in the church, I turned down because I didn't know what I was doing. And I felt like I was a fraud, and I felt really unprepared. So what that means is a lot of times we'll say no, but God still nudges us and pushes us and leads us in a particular direction. So that no did not shape my future. It was important to me at the time because I learned that, you know, when we say no, that's not the end of it. God is going to continue to bring that forth in our life. So the passage I want to pull out of that whole chapter is, for as in one body we have many members, and not all the members have the same function, so we who are many are one body in Christ, and individually we are members one of another. We have gifts that are that differ according to the grace given to us, prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the exhorter in exhortation, the giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, the compassionate in cheerfulness. That's the passage I want us to talk about today when we talk about gifts. Because we use this word, the body of Christ. It's used several times in that passage. And, I mean, that's such a churchy phrase, the body of Christ. And I still struggle sometimes getting my head around churchy words. So I want to tell you the way that I like to think about the body of Christ. To me, the body of Christ is community. Community. It's how we all fit together and work together. Work together, sharing our gifts. So how is it that community is formed? Community is simply formed by by each of us doing our part in being the body of Christ. Community is formed. Community is formed by truly being open to possibilities. Today, I know we had a lot of possibilities put out for you today, and I really appreciate each of you that signed up for that. And there may be some of you that turn around and say, no, it wasn't what I expected, like I did, turn down my first job. No, it's not really what I was expecting. But as long as we continue to be open to one another and to this community in doing our part, finding our place to do our part, we are the body of Christ. I find some people, they'll come to the church for a while and all they'll do is sit in the pew. And then they'll say, it didn't work out, I didn't find enough reason to keep coming. Were they ever a part of our community? They never found a way to be a part. And so it was easy for them not to return. We form community when we find our place and do our work and share our gifts. A great way to find your place is to walk willingly, open to the nudging that is all around us. Walk willingly means that today the nudging was really public. We have a brochure to go with all that nudging today. But on other Sundays, it might not be that public, but those opportunities are still there. They're not only in this place, but in every bit of our lives. That nudging is around us constantly. So when we walk willingly, we walk openly, we live open to the nudging of God's presence. Where can we do our part, not only in this community, but in the greater community of God's presence in the world? We ask everyone to do a part in building this community because we assume that you and each and every one of us is gifted. Now, for some people, that's really humbling. Some of us may have lived in the church all of our lives. That's no big deal. Of course I'm gifted. For some people, that is profound to know that when they walk in the door, we assume they are gifted. To walk openly to the nudging of God is to believe that we're gifted and we can share. So community, this body of Christ, is this interception between the whole, we're all in it together, and the individual. We're pretty good at this individualism in America. I'm going to do this. This is what I'm going to accomplish. This is what I want. I. Community is that interception of, I want to be a part of something bigger and larger. Building community intersects with our individual ability. Sometimes that need for the community is not always a perfect match with what that individual might self-identify as their gift. I can't tell you how many times I've had a job and in my mind, I see all of you sitting here. And one of my superpowers, I believe God has given me, is that when I meet people, I see possibilities. I say, oh, I see gifts in this person. And so as I'm looking in my mind's eye of you and I have this job, and I think, oh, I should ask, and I think of two or three people. And honestly, I have been told when I've asked some people about a certain job, no, I can't do that. I saw something in them that they did not self-identify as their gift. So sometimes the community will ask something of you that you might not self-identify as your gift. being open to the nudging of God might call you to do something you're not quite ready to do, and you need the courage to try. That's okay. Nobody's perfect here. We try things and might not work out. No big deal. I just ask that as part of this community, you try. You try new things. The passage says we have gifts that are different according to the grace given to us. Gifts can be discovered. They can be uncovered. They can be experimented with. They can be refined. All in this community that we call the body of Christ. That first job that I turned down, sometimes we say yes to things, and then we turn around and say no, and then realize that we should have said yes and kept our faith. The work of God is always white for the harvest. It's always ready to be harvested. If you say no, no problem. There'll be something else. Our community is actually our greatest asset. I've had non-church members, people outside in the world that I'm friends with that don't attend this church, that have told me, you know, I don't know what I believe. I don't know if I could come to church. But that community part, that you're a part of a community, that seems really awesome. That's the part that they long for, to let go of that individualism and to be a part of something bigger. That's one of our greatest assets. We might think these stained glass windows are phenomenal. We might think there's something special about having a place on Main Street. What's really important is that we have community. We are the body of Christ. I was told this recently about the redwoods just down the road from us. Now they are the tallest trees on the planet. And the way that they can be so tall is that their roots connect with each other. They lock in to each other. And it makes them stronger so that they can go taller. Now, this person that was telling me, you know, I don't know what I believe, but you have community. That's really what she was telling me. I can only go so tall because I'm standing all alone. But what I long for is someone to interconnect with so that I can really see just how tall my life can be. That's what we are doing when we create community. That's the way when we share our gifts, that's the outcome of them, that we can grow so much taller as the body of Christ. Amen. Kimberly will come.